Tonight, a former councillor defends the actions of ex-CCC councillors who reportedly signed checks after a new team was sworn in. The principal of SMC to beef up security at the institution after bandits attack and rob students on compound. Police investigate a shooting in Le Clery that left one man in critical condition. And the Ministry of Health braces for an increase in mosquito-borne illness as the rains become more frequent. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Wednesday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. Our top story. The Castries Constituency's Council has been clearing the air on a situation involving over a dozen of its daily paid workers. The St. Lucia Seamen and the General Workers Union wrote to the Labour Commissioner this week to complain about the CCC's dismissal of the workers. The Council has also been addressing reports that former councillors were transacting business on its behalf even after a new team had been sworn in. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news coverage.
The Castries City Council says the workers operated on a temporary 3-month basis and, as part of the council's efforts to restructure the management of its finances, decided not to renew the contracts. Some of the workers, according to the council, have been working on this temporary arrangement since 2014, and the relevant authorities did not see the need to regularize their status.
That on this temporary arrangement, you have a carpenter, you have a mason, who have been working continuously on a 3-month basis, even no break. It's not to say they break out the floor and then they come back. Continuously. And you have not seen the reason to give them full employment. There must be something wrong.
The council continues its investigations into a matter involving an employee where that individual who worked under the previous administration allegedly facilitated the signing of checks by former councillors on behalf of the organization following the appointment of a new board under the UWP regime. Mayor of Castries Peterson Francis claims that the transactions were conducted without the knowledge of the board, but former CCC official and co-signatory Evarista Jamari said that the individual in question did nothing wrong since the checks were signed in order to keep the day-to-day operations running smoothly and were signed with the full knowledge of the minister in charge.
And even if he went to them, there's nothing they could have done because they were not signatories to the account. And that's what we were trying to avoid from the very beginning, to ensure the smooth running and avoid disruption. And this involved paying daily paid workers and paying normal suppliers. They're not doing anything new. So it's rather, you know, disappointing that here you are trying to take a moral high ground to do things the proper way. Because we could have taken the position of not signing any checks from the day that they were asked to, the board was asked to resign.
Jean-Marie says the transactions were conducted in good faith. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Meanwhile, new councillors have been sworn onto the Groseley and Miku North constituency councils. Both groups have been challenged by the respective MPs to adopt a more integrated approach to local government and community development. Kendall Burton explains.
In Groseley, MP Leonard Montout called for a holistic approach to addressing poverty and unemployment in the constituency and to helping struggling families and neighborhoods. He called for the council to see its responsibility as more than timely collection of garbage and rather as that of changing lives through the adoption of multifaceted strategies to community development. There are a number of socio-economic issues confronting the constituency, he says, which need to be addressed, and which run the gamut from youth unemployment to stray dogs.
I have had preliminary discussions with SLAPS, and I believe, and I'm saying so for the benefit of the council, one of the requirements is that we provide SLAPS with a bond for keeping of those dogs to get them off the streets. So I am saying I will be working hand in hand with you as we collaborate with SLAPS in ensuring that we get those stray dogs off the streets.
Focusing on the popular Groseley Street Party, he said it was in dire need of an overhaul. Considering that most of the hotel plants are within the constituency, he is unconvinced that the constituency is benefiting as much as it could from the tourism sector. The council, he says, has an important role to play in changing that, as it does in developing the constituency's human resource. Human resource development is also a priority for the Mikud North MP, Dr. Gail Rigobert.
There are many other areas of life that are invisible to the naked eye that require our attention as well. And we will discuss in detail some of the areas that require urgent intervention regarding the holistic development of the people of this constituency.
Dr. Rigobert went a step further to challenge the council members to ensure that every staff member of the constituency council, from the janitor to the clerk, are afforded opportunities for training and personal development. Both MPs reminded councillors of the important role they play in overall governance, as well as the importance of accountability and the delivery of quality services according to local needs and priorities. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
In other news, one man is in critical condition following a shooting incident in Laclary. Don Nicholas has the details.
According to reports, 48-year-old Don Desir Citygate was shot in the abdomen. The brother of the victim said he received a call in the early hours of Wednesday informing him of the sad news. Urban Desir says from what he heard, his brother may have been shot multiple times.
We could not see him because he was in surgery. We left there probably about after 8:30, and he got out of surgery, but he's in a critical condition. But no one briefed us as to anything, per se, for now. So there's very little that I could say on his condition, but he did not look promising.
Daisy said that his brother suffered bouts of mental illness and during those periods would be inclined to inflict damage to other people's property, especially motor vehicles. Because of this, Daisy says it is not surprising that his brother may have made some enemies.
He has a mental issue, and a lot of persons accuse him of doing any stuff in terms of their vehicles, their property and stuff, when the so-called mental thing is on him. You know, so then it is not far-fetched to figure that something of that nature could happen to him. Okay. Because, you know, persons handle the problems differently.
The shooting occurred around 1 a.m. today. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The principal of the St. Mary's College says he has sought the urgent help of the Ministry of Education in securing the school after a group of students were accosted and robbed by bandits while on school property. Alex Buske reports.
On Tuesday, September 6, St. Mary's College students were accosted and robbed of their personal belongings while on the school compound. School's principal, Rohan Sion, says this is the first for the over 100-year-old institution.
When some guys left the bottom, two rogue elements came up from the back of the school, they climbed up the little access track going onto the field, and jumped a fence at the back. Imagine that, came into the area where the boys were playing the football and stuff, accosted four of them who were on the side with knives, took the fellas' phones and wallets right in the compound during school hours. It wasn't much shocking than that.
Mr. Sion says St. Mary's College has always been a safe place for students and teachers alike, and now this.
I'm absolutely livid, man. I mean, I've been here for years. This, nothing so has ever happened. We always say this is a very safe place because it is a safe place. We don't have people loitering around this area. But the times have turned so badly on us. And look what has happened. Now we have to do all kinds of things. We have to get cameras and get the security elements up here now. There are times we didn't even have a fence there before. When I started to teach here and I was vice principal, there wasn't even a fence. Now we have to put a fence, you have to put barbed wire.
Now the irate principal is contemplating whether they have to worry about the bandits returning, this time with guns. Special security, he says, is what the school is now seeking.
So clearly, we're going to have to deal with this thing at a serious level. The ministry does not normally provide security of that kind for the schools. We have caretakers whose job it is to look around and check this and that. But they do all kinds of other things, carrying furniture, cleaning places, so they're very busy. We need people now specialized in security, whose job it is just to keep the place safe. And it's a shame that St. Lucia should come to that.
Since no one really hangs around the Vigi area, Mr. Sion says, this shows that this malicious act was premeditated. He says the college will take serious measures to prevent a reoccurrence. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Alex Bousquet.
And now this story. Newly sworn in members of various constituency councils have been called upon to put service delivery above politics. The challenge came from local government minister, Senator Fortuna Bellrose, as the department held orientation exercises for the newly sworn in councillors. Kendall Burton has the details.
Most of the councils feature a mix of experienced councillors and rookies. The orientation exercise served as a reminder for the veterans and an introduction for the newbies to the important role they are expected to play in the development of their various communities. However, they were cautioned against mixing politics and development.
All I ask of you in delivering your service is to be professional. Be professional. Recognize that you are there to give service, and not just service to one set of the people. This is a government for all the people. All the people, not the UWP, not the SLP. It's the government for all the people. And as councillors, despite what political party you support, as councillors, you have a responsibility to be the example in the community that serves all.
Councillors were encouraged to take a participatory approach to community development, one that encourages leadership from within the community, one that supports and develops local capacities for community-based development and facilitates a collaborative relationship between communities and constituency councils. They were encouraged to ensure transparency, accountability, and the delivery of quality public services. Undoubtedly, they were told it was going to be a tough 2 years ahead, with a lot of demands and a small to non-existent budget. Innovation, they were told, would have to be the order of the day.
We feel that as a ministry, we need to prepare you for the role as constituency council members. Some of you, fortunately, may already have the experience because you've done it before. Some of you are new to this. So the objective for us today is to ensure that we give you the tools that you need to be able to perform as effectively as possible in your new roles.
The department hopes this week's orientation meeting will be the first of several such gatherings of the councillors. For the DBS Newsworld, Kendall Burton reporting.
Time now for Street Vibes. Here is your presenter.
Hi, I'm Alex Bousquet, and you're watching Street Vibes. Today, the people speak to an open mic.
I have a problem with the politicians in St. Lucia. Number one, I heard Mr. Hille talking about they are giving work all over in Kasui South, and he hopes the politicians do things the right way. I wonder if Mr. Hille knows that for the 5 or 10 years Robert Louis spent there, he never gave one flab of work. All the work you have been given is to labors, and I can call the labor's name, which I will not.
Well, as you know, the country, we just had an election, and the country is financially in disarray. No money. I heard of some contracts, I call them false contracts, because I know any political contract is at the term of your office. If you call election before time, and any contract you give is null and void, right? So I believe the Prime Minister has to take the bull by the horn.
I think, as I said before, I mean, we are blessed with beautiful ladies, but I believe our young ladies need to dress appropriately, more decently, you know what I mean? Avoid exposing everything, you know what I mean? And, you know, you don't want to lead any man into temptation, man, you know what I mean? And whatever you have supposed to be for you and your husband, you know what I mean? And, you know what I mean? Just, you know, dress good. That's all I have to say today.
You should just check what they're doing and what they're saying. I also heard Mr. Hille was saying about the SSDF, how they give one set of people books. But I have sent to SSDF by Spider and Joachim Henry, don't give me nothing.
You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Bousquet, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You are watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, remembering Sir John Compton, and the Ministry of Health braces for an increase in mosquito-borne illnesses. Welcome back to the DBS News World. Members of the ruling United Workers' Party have been remembering former Prime Minister Sir John Compton on the anniversary of his passing. Sir John Compton died on the 7th of September 2007. He had served as St. Lucia's Prime Minister, as well as the island's Chief Minister and the first and only Premier. Don Nicholas tells us more.
Sir John George Melvin Compton was a St. Lucian politician who served as the Prime Minister of St. Lucia on three occasions, 1964 to 1979, again from 1982 to 1996, and from 2006 until his death in 2007. Sir John was known as a no-nonsense leader, one who was decisive in his approach to matters. Today marks 9 years since his passing.
Sir John founded the United Workers' Party in 1964 after an already colorful life in St. Lucia's political history. Sir John has inspired the growth of the party, and his ideals continue to serve as an inspiration for our current leader, Mr. Alan Chastney. We recognize Sir John's deep commitment to the United Workers' Party and St. Lucia, and his role in as a dominating figure in regional development.
Initially, Sir John had worked as Trade Minister in the Labour administration led by Sir George Charles. However, Sir John later formed his own United Workers' Party in 1964 and stamped his authority in the political arena. Sir John won the admiration of even his most fierce political opponents. According to Mr. Mears, at his death, it was the St. Lucia Labour Party that erected his monument.
Sir John was often embraced by even his fiercest opponents because of his nature. I think he embodied what it meant to care for all equally, despite the person's political persuasion. He was certainly a strategist, and his long life in politics shows how much the people truly loved and admired him. Sir John was a man of great conviction, and he remained very humble to the end.
In 1996, Sir John handed over the reins of the party to Dr. Vaughan Lewis, but made a return to active politics in 2006, where he led his party to victory at the polls. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In law enforcement news, on Tuesday, September the 6th of 2016, a post-mortem was conducted on the body of 66-year-old Dennis Fauché, better known as Two-Pence of Abdeline in Meku. The examination revealed that he died as a result of ligature strangulation. Fauché had been missing since August 24th, but his body was found hanging from a tree in Escap on Sunday.
Presently, the cause of death is clear. What is not clear is the manner of death. So we're not sure if we cannot conclusively say that we're dealing with a suicide or a homicide. So this is the reason why investigations are continuing into this matter, so that we could make that determination as to exactly what we're dealing with.
Corporal Hippolyte was asked whether there are persons of interest assisting the police.
At this point in time, I'm not able to say exactly what extra investigation we're dealing with, but just know that investigations are continuing, because we need to ensure, like I said, what we're dealing with, if it is either suicide or that of a homicide. At this point in time, we're not able to clearly say what it is.
In other news, the Ministry of Health is appealing to parents and school administrators to keep children safe from mosquito-borne viruses by reducing breeding sites. With the hurricane season now at its peak and the rains coming more frequently, the ministry is concerned that there could be a spike in cases of dengue, chikungunya, or Zika, as in previous years.
So far, the Ministry of Education has taken quite a proactive approach in terms of the measures that they've put in place to reduce the impact of vector-borne diseases. They have provided information to the district education officers and also to the principals on different environmental measures that need to be put in place at the schools to get the necessary support. Before the opening of school, they've also instituted environmental measures to reduce the breeding grounds of the Aedes aegypti mosquitoes that most people know by now is the main vector for those vector-borne diseases.
The Ministry of Education has done its part by repairing roofs and guttering and getting rid of stagnant water near schools. But the Ministry of Health is appealing to teachers and school administrators to stay vigilant. Earlier, the Environmental Health Department held a special training for janitors and caretakers at primary and secondary schools.
We wanted to build capacity within the school compound. So if, let's say, students are complaining that they're seeing mosquitoes, then the cleaners or caretakers would be able to identify where the problem is coming from and how it is that they could address that situation.
Parents are also requested to keep children with any of the conditions at home and to take steps to ensure their children are protected while at school. This may mean having them wear leggings or other protective clothing, as well as applying mosquito repellents to their skin. The Victoria Hospital launched its Volunteer for Healthcare program this week. The program hopes to attract young people who want to contribute to the development of the healthcare system or who are interested in a career in the healthcare field. More in this report.
The program is the brainchild of the executive director of the hospital, Mrs. Jeanette Hughes. As the staff prepare to move to the new Owen King EO Hospital, she recognizes that they will need a lot of help, both in the short and long term, to make the transition. Volunteers in the program will help full-time staff fulfill their mission while making the transition. While it is open to persons who want to simply help others and have no experience in healthcare, it is also designed to give persons with an interest in healthcare some exposure to the public health system.
Out of those volunteers, we want to create future professionals. We all heard a cry of health professionals in St. Lucia and other persons that the care that they receive is sometimes suboptimal. We want to create super professionals, if you may. We want to create professionals who care about people and who care about delivery of healthcare. So the program is structured in such a way to expose young persons and persons who volunteer to many aspects of healthcare delivery.
Speakers at the launch emphasized the important role that volunteers could play from improving people's experience of care to improving public health and reducing health inequalities. But nobody is as well qualified to talk about the important support that volunteers can provide than a volunteer. Danielle Gordon is one such person who has volunteered her time with the Ezra Long Laboratory, where she set up a post-mortem database.
Although I've gone away to school, I've come back, and I think that my foundation, I need to give back. So this is why I opted to give back to Ezra Long Laboratory. I also volunteered at the Royal St. Lucia Police Force, where I did the exhibit submission database for them as well. It's called eSIMS, where we have the storage of exhibits being tracked as well. It's always important to give back to where you started.
The hope is that the program will help ease the tremendous pressure that the local healthcare system is under and help to improve the quality and efficiency of services. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
Time now for Core Values with Hannah Jang.
Peace Corps volunteers serve for 2 years at their assigned schools around St. Lucia and focus on improving English literacy. Since the project at each school is designed to be 6 years long, that means that after one volunteer completes their 2 years of service, a new volunteer will usually take their place at the same school. Just recently, Peace Corps volunteer Grace Kilbane completed her service at the Souffre Infant School.
My 2 years in Souffre has been really wonderful. The community of Souffre has really become my home. The people here have treated me so well and have opened their houses and their hearts to me and really made me feel like family. And I've been so blessed to have this experience of working at the school and meeting all my friends and now family in Souffre.
A new Peace Corps volunteer, Catherine Maitland, is now following at the infant school. Just as Grace integrated into the community of Souffre, Catherine hopes to do the same.
I love walking down the street and seeing so many people that I know and saying good morning, good afternoon, good night to so many people. So it's really made me feel welcome here just in the past month that I've been living here.
Both volunteers shared the same host mother in Souffre, a woman who helped Grace transition into the community 2 years ago and who is doing the same now for Catherine.
It was really nice having them. I took them with an open heart. I wanted them to be happy. I wanted them to feel welcome. I wanted them to be at home. So I opened up my door. I opened up my home to them. I didn't want them to go hungry because they were not at home. I didn't want them to be sad because they were not at home. I wanted them to feel welcome in St. Lucia.
Catherine started co-teaching at the Soufre Infant School this week, and so far she has been happily surprised to find similarities between her experiences teaching in the States and teaching here.
At the last school where I was student teaching, there was a really great community among the teachers, and I thought, oh my gosh, am I ever going to find a community, a school community like that again? But then at the first staff meeting at the Soufre Infant School, I was like, oh, it exists in St. Lucia too. So I was really happy to find that as well.
Grace and Joanna both have been introducing Catherine to people and places in Soufre. Some of the things that Joanna has found important to share with Catherine have been around keeping safe, finding the right social circle, and preparing local food.
You know, I thought of myself being them away in a foreign land, in a foreign country. You know, like, you know, nobody in this place. So I wanted them, you know, I put myself in their shoes. Like I did for them what I would have liked another person to do for me if I was in a foreign country.
As the former volunteer at the infant school, Grace offered her advice to Catherine for how to make the most of her 2 years ahead.
I think really just for her to be herself, there's so many things that she will learn from the people of Soufre, and then also other things that the people of Soufre will learn from her. And I think just having being comfortable and open-minded with that cultural exchange will help her be successful.
The story of continued service in Soufre demonstrates how the relationships that Peace Corps volunteers have with each other, with their communities, and with their host families can really make a difference in their time here in St. Lucia. For Core Values, I'm Hannah Jang.
Please stay with the broadcast, because when we come back in just a moment, who has been impersonating Lionel Ellis? Welcome back to the DBS News World. The Caribbean Institute of Certified Management Consultants is hosting its third annual conference in St. Lucia under the theme Enhancing the Export Competitiveness of Caribbean Professional Services Through Innovation, Quality Standards, and Market Access. The three-day conference has brought together management consultants and professionals from around the region to discuss the need for standards, certification, and innovation to improve exportability of professional services. Don Nicholas has more.
The workshop held by the Caribbean Institute of Certified Management Consultants sought to harness the skills of participants as service providers. Several representatives from around the region took part in the workshop.
The theme for this year focuses on developing the export of services, of professional services. So during the course of today, we will have a number of presentations and panel discussions that will look at the state of the export of professional services. They look at what the opportunities are for increasing the exports of professional services, and we'll also discuss what we as management consultants and similar professionals can do to improve our readiness for export and the quality of our services.
Some of the participants will be in a position to export their services online, while others will have to travel to promote their businesses. Whatever the case, the whole objective is to bring the attendees up to speed with international requirements.
So over the last few years, there have been a number of professionals in the Caribbean in a range of professions who have been exporting their services. However, I think we all agree that the scope for increase is there, and that there is a lot more that we can do to take advantage of the opportunities.
The workshop is being held at the Bay Gardens Hotel. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The communications manager of the ruling United Workers Party, Lionel Ellis, has reportedly fallen victim to a con artist who has been impersonating him in order to trick people into parting with large sums of money. Mr. Ellis says he has received numerous reports of this. In one incident, a woman reportedly paid the trickster U.S. $350 for what he convinced her was charitable cause.
I've been informed by, called by many of my friends who are on Facebook, and they have indicated to me that somebody is soliciting money with my name, Lionel James Ellis. Now, I wrote it off for a few days, but it has become serious because somebody, a friend of mine, has called me, and this lady apparently gave the person money through some banking means. They had to deposit some money or send money to them. It's in excess of $350 US.
We continue the broadcast with news that Grozile MP Leonard Spider Motut has challenged more businesses to form partnerships with schools to help prepare today's students for tomorrow. He made the call while receiving a check from Veuve St. Lucia to one of the top performers in this year's common entrance exams.
Veuve St. Lucia presented a check for $1,000 to Shaquin Prudent and his mother at a short ceremony at the MP's office. Leonard Montout would like to see more businesses follow Veuve's lead by investing in the education of the nation's youth. Montout says it's imperative that business people recognize the importance of the educational system in economic development and partner with educators to improve it.
This is the kind of support we want from the corporate society, particularly those that are operating in our constituency, when they partner with us in this way and support efforts and initiatives such as education. I think that ensures that we are going to have a good and vibrant community with young people that are very productive and who can make a contribution in the future.
A big fan of rewarding hard work, Montout says, students are encouraged to perform better when there is the prospect of some form of reward or recognition, a sentiment shared by the management of Veuve.
We value hard work and we like to show gratitude and to show encouragement, and as a token of our appreciation and to reward Shaquin on doing so well, we thought this was important to do.
A former student of the Dame Paulette Primary School, Shaquin Prudent ranked among the top 10 performers in this year's common entrance exams. He and his mother were extremely grateful for the acknowledgement and support from Veuve.
I'd like to tell you thank you for the contribution for my son, Shaquin. It will go a long way.
Veuve, thank you for the contribution of $1,000 towards my school life. I hope that you know I'll take it into great use. Yeah, thank you.
Mr. Montout has plans to remodel the National Student Award Scheme started several years ago. He hopes more businesses will embrace the opportunity to be part of that initiative as well. For the DBS News World, Kendall Burton reporting.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues with Brian Calixt.
Good evening, welcome to the DBS Sports. We kick off with news on football. The press launch of the Blackheart 2016 Knockout Football Tournament was held this morning at the Oberst Surfing Hotel. Our cameras caught up with one of the organizers, David Shakes Christopher.
Well, today is the 14th annual, the launch of the 14th annual Blackheart SLFA Knockout Football Tournament. It's a tournament which everybody knows has become a household staple for persons when it comes to football yearly. This year we'll be seeing 16 teams taking part in the tournament, vying for big prize money, $30,000. We'll be unveiling our two platinum sponsors today in Guinness and Flo. We have persons from the Ministry of Youth and Sports will be represented here also. We have the president of the Football Association also will be here, and other sponsors and well-wishers. So what we're doing today is launching off the tournament. We will be exposing or presenting our sponsors for this year's tournament. And Monday, we'll have the draw, where we will be matching up the teams and the release of the booklets. So basically, in a nutshell, is the launch, the start of big things to come, which commence on the 17th of September to the 8th of October.
We also spoke with Rohan Lovens, representing Guinness, who is one of the platinum sponsors for this year's tournament.
A premium or a platinum sponsor of Blackheart. We've been so for the last, I'd say, probably as long as the tournament has been, probably about 10 years. The relationship has been, like I say, symbiotic. It's almost a perfect relationship. Guinness is football. Guinness is made of more. Blackheart is the same. We've worked with Blackheart, even with the Guinness Street football. We've worked with them on community activations and tournaments and whatnot. And I think that it's really exciting because we're almost coming to the climax of the football season for the year. Blackheart is a big thing. It's big for the brand. It's why we're here. It's really an exciting time for Guinness. I mean, just to close off essentially the year, and then that grassroots connection with not only your Guinness drinkers, but your general Blackheart fans, it's just a perfect relationship. In fact, I'm Guinness will be running a number of promotions, especially in the communities, at community bars in particular, which is really at the core of where your drinkers are and your Blackheart fans. There'll be lots of giveaways, the Blackheart tickets, or number of the activities, the number of matches taking place, the finals, the semi-finals, but not to mention there are a lot of Guinness items that persons can actually win. But not only that, what we're trying to do is to bring persons into this Guinness family, to give them a sense as to this is what the brand is all about, and really it's about reward for them, just reward for being a Guinness drinker, a Guinness consumer, a Blackheart fan. So that's the connection that we're going to have going on.
This year's tournament is being dedicated to Brian McDonald, a long-serving member and organizer of the Blackheart tournament, who passed away earlier this year. The official fixtures and release of the tournament booklet is set for Monday 12th at a venue to be announced. Carrying tired legs and bodies like many of the professional athletes who've been competing for the better part of 2016, St. Lucia's world-class athlete jumped her way to a third-place finish in the final World Challenge meeting of the 2016 season, which was held on September 6th in Zagreb, Croatia. On a very cold night when the top three places were only able to clear a similar height of 1.89 meters, the event was on comeback, won by Olympic finalist Svetlana Radzivil of Uzbekistan, with Yulia Lyubchenko of Ukraine placing second and our own St. Lucian Laverne Spencer in third position. The star athlete from St. Lucia recently created history by becoming the first St. Lucian to make the finals of an Olympics, and following that, created further history by placing second overall in the 2016 Diamond Race behind Olympic champion Ruth Berthier of Spain. Spencer is now preparing for her final competition of her highly successful 2016 season on September 6th in Brussels, Belgium, following which she's expected home for some much-needed rest. Stay tuned, more sports after the break. Thank you for staying tuned. Six of the ICC's 10 full members, Australia, England, South Africa, New Zealand, Pakistan and the West Indies, are thought to have supported the plan. However, the Board of Control for Cricket in India was the most significant opponent of the idea. But cricket's governing body did reveal proposals for a test championship playoff match every 2 years, and said they hope to introduce it by 2019. One of the chief executives at Wednesday's meeting told Quick Info there was no vote over the Test Championship, but that India, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh and Zimbabwe had opposed the idea. A recent survey from International Players Union FICA revealed 72% of respondents called for a divisional test competition. India's opposition to the proposals concerned the effects on the smaller test nations. In 2013, the ICC unveiled plans for the World Test Championship to replace the 50-over Champions Trophy in the international calendar and be played in 2017, but these were dismissed the following year. And finally, tonight in news on tennis, 10th seed Carolina Pliskova cruised into the U.S. Open semifinals with a straight set defeat of Anna Kondrzej. Pliskova of the Czech Republic triumphed 6-2, 6-2 to reach the last four of a Grand Slam for the first time in New York. Pliskova, 24, will face either fifth seed Simona Halep or world number one Serena Williams in Friday's semifinal. Meanwhile, Caroline Wozniacki made it through to a fifth U.S. Open semifinal by beating injured Latvian opponent Asnaskia Sevastova 6-love, 6-2 at Flushing Meadows. Sevastova needed heavy strapping on her right ankle after falling awkwardly in only the second game. Dane Wozniacki, who is unseeded in New York after slipping to 74th in the world, will play German second seed Angelique Kerber in the last four. Kerber, 29, defeated Italy's Roberta Vinci, the 2015 finalist, 7-5, 6-love. Meanwhile, world number one Serena Williams set a new Grand Slam record of 308 victories with a win over Yaroslava Shabdova of Kazakhstan at the U.S. Open in New York. The American, 34, won 6-2, 6-3 to pass Roger Federer in the all-time list of matches won at the tennis majors. She moves on to the quarterfinals, where she will face Romanian fifth seed Simona Halep, who beat Spain's Carla Suarez Navarro 6-2, 7-5. In men's action, defending champion Novak Djokovic is through to the U.S. Open semifinals after a knee injury forced Joe Winifred Songa to quit when trailing 6-3, 6-2. Djokovic, 29, has completed just 2 of 5 matches in New York, benefiting from a walkover and 2 retirements. He will face another Frenchman in the last 4 after Gael Monfils beat compatriot Lucas Pouille 6-4, 6-3, 6-3. Stay tuned, the weather is up next. Now to a thought to take you through the 9. Problems are not stop signs. They are guidelines. The DBS News continues. Please stay tuned.
On the lighter side tonight, this bizarre footage shows women on a motorway flagging down motorists in their underwear and begging them for £1 sterling to buy clothes. Wearing just knickers, bras and high heels, the group were reportedly attempting to entice the drivers in Russia to part with their hard-earned cash. The women were taking part in a 3-day course, teaching them how to find a husband. And this odd task was one of the lessons. The women had apparently paid some 25,000 rubles or around £250 sterling to take part in the 3-day event. Time now for the usual reminder. A former councillor defends the actions of ex-CCC councillors who reportedly signed checks after a new team was sworn in. The principal of SMC to beef up security at the institution after bandits attack and rob students on compound. Police investigate a shooting in Le Clery that left one man in critical condition. And the Ministry of Health braces for an increase in mosquito-borne illness as the rains become more frequent. And that's the DBS News World. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the broadcast. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polio, wishing you a very good evening and inviting you to stay with us coming up at 8:30 tonight. Newsmaker Live. See you then.